Let's begin. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Rector's Forum. We're thrilled you're here. If you are visiting with us, a very warm and special greeting to each of you. If you would like to receive an email blast from me every Thursday describing what will be happening in this room every Sunday, we would love to have you register for that. There are sign-up sheets over there, clipboards with green sheets that you can sign up. We also have red welcome bags for every one of you. They contain brochures describing all the different ministries at All Saints Church. We would love to have you as a pledging member of All Saints. There are pledge cards around. All you have to do is ask a member and they'll sign you up to be a pledging member of All Saints Church. At All Saints Church, we put our faith into action. We try to. Every week, we have some kind of focus about some change that we think the world needs. Today, we're focusing on eliminating the death penalty in California. We ask those of you who are California voters to sign a petition at all the actions table sites, please, today, so that we can have this proposition on the ballot to put an end to the death penalty, put an end to state-sponsored torture. Before I introduce our beloved friend and teacher and guest, I simply want to give you a tour through some of the very best books you could ever buy and read. Immortal Diamond is one of the most magnificent books about the true self as an experience of the resurrection you could ever read. Falling Upward is absolutely a threshold book about moving from a dualistic life to a non-dualistic life once we all have those experiences that call us to a deeper life. Yes And is a compilation of many of the daily meditations of Richard, and this is stunning reading, and it's designed that you can just read one page each day. The Naked Now is a wonderful introduction to seeing as mystics see. What the Mystics Know, another important book. Silent Compassion, Finding God in Contemplation. Breathing Underwater, Spirituality in the 12 Steps. And Eager to Love, which is my absolute favorite Richard Rohr book. I could take up 5 minutes describing who he is. You don't need any. Oh, I forgot to welcome everybody who's streaming. Last Sunday on Easter Sunday, we had 449 individual streamers from Mozambique to Iowa. It was just an amazing experience. So, welcome all of you who are streaming with us. As I said in the 9 a.m. liturgy, there simply is no one who has had more beneficial impact on the theology of All Saints Church and of my thinking in the past 20 years than Richard Rohr. He is offering us a new way to see the redemptive, healing, and transformative power of Christianity, healthy Christianity. Will you please warmly welcome Richard Rohr.
You're very kind, Ed. Thank you. It's a joy to be back with you. I'm amazed this many people came after what I threw at you in the homily. I thought you'd be running home writing to your bishops. Okay, so I did mean what I tried to say there, that I think I do believe Christianity as we have mostly known it is still in its infantile stages. And what was given to us, well, understandably, it just reflected history. We couldn't do a lot better than that, except in mystical, non-dual thinkers' minds, which isn't most people. We were handed a tribal religion. And I think, as I tried to illustrate, I think it was meant to be a cosmic message, not a tribal message. Huh? And this explains much of our still remaining silly competition with the other world religions and the competitive mind, the winning mind, which so many Christians seem to have. Of course, we frame the gospel itself in terms of a win-lose scenario. Huh? So just set us up for Western capitalism. It doesn't set us up for the gospel, all right? Because it's all about winning. Does the recent political debate, does that need any proof? And the fact that Christians can even buy that as vaguely Christian defies analysis, unless you don't know the gospel. And it's an awful lot of us. It's not their fault. I'm not here to blame anybody. I think we just feel so lucky to live in this time where consciousness can see things in a different way. And we are lucky as Christians to have the scriptures to back us up with that. Now, people say, well, why didn't other people, or certainly a lot of people smarter than I, but you can only see what you're told to pay attention to. For years, we had Brian McLaren, one of the leaders in, has he ever spoken here, Brian?
Yes.
Emerging Church. And he used to show this video, maybe some of you saw it, where the room is divided into two groups, and he says, I'm going to show you a little video. Now, I want you on this side to count how many times the guys dressed in black throw the ball to the guys dressed in white. And I want you to count over here how many times the people dressed in white, so everybody's set up to win. You know, we want to get the right answer. Going back to first grade school, I'm sure. You know? Well, we're all counting how the ball goes back and forth and he opens it up how many times. It's amazing how many still got it wrong after watching so carefully. But then he says what just blew us away, some of you know. Did any of you notice there was a gorilla walking across the screen? He says, let me re-show it to you. And there it is, a guy in a gorilla suit walking right. 96% to 98% of people never see the gorilla. You can only see what you're told to pay attention to. And as I mentioned in the homily at Mass, the interpretation of the gospel the most all of us were given was a win-lose scenario that ended up making God a dictator, rather unlikable, who told us to love unconditionally, but he didn't. And he was a he, too, by the way. Who told us to forgive 70 times 7, but God didn't. Did you ever think of that? That's a contradiction at the heart of our preaching of the gospel, huh? That God became less loving than most people you know. Most people you know would not torture their enemies for all eternity, would they? Would they? I always say maybe for a day or so, but for all eternity, just feel that. This is an unworkable message of redemption. And it has no notion of historic salvation or God saving history, which is very clear in the Hebrew scriptures. But the West moved toward the exaltation of the isolated individual, and we Americans are the product of that, probably the most individualistic culture the world has ever known. We can't even seek the common good anymore. And that's why our message of social justice, of course, is so important. So I read the bulletin there during Mass, and I saw you'd given me a title for this talk. Forgive me that I forgot it.
Forget it.
I was supposed to talk on radical compassion, but actually I am talking on that. And when I mentioned in the homily that Jesus returns to history as the forgiving victim, that's the basis of radical compassion. But when you have a God who is not compassionate, and when the necessary redemption of the world is by an act of required violence. If you were raised in evangelical circles or conservative Catholic circles, you were raised on what we call the substitutionary atonement theory. It almost stops in my mouth, it's so silly. Even calling it a theory, at least they admitted it was a theory, you know? But it's all transactional religion. Not transformational, transactional. Can you feel the difference between those two words? And a huge divine transaction was necessary between Jesus and his Father. And who didn't come out very good in the story? The Father. Now, some of you know from my men's work where it all started with men largely coming together to talk about their often disastrous relationships with their fathers. or the absent father in their life, or the abusive father, or the father who was killed in war, much of history was simply programmed to accept that fathers are ogres. And it just projected right onto God the Father. That's why I'm writing the book on the Trinity, because we gotta put Jesus back in the Trinity before the whole scenario of salvation makes sense, what's happening, you know? And basically, the Jesus you were presented was pulled outside of the eternal flow of infinite love, and we pushed him back on the throne. You see this in most cathedral art in most of Europe. He's now sitting on the throne. He has become the old man with the white beard, now judging history just like the Father. Huh? And this doesn't liberate. There's no vulnerability, as we see in the naked, bleeding body of Jesus, who is the most, most unlikely image of God. You got to utterly take off your head, shake it, and put it back on if you're going to accept that Jesus is the image of the invisible God. Because what you were raised with, what I was raised with, was a God who was omnipotent, omniscient, omni, everything, all right? And then we get this picture, a naked, bleeding man, the ultimate loser, who becomes the forgiving victim and undoes it all from inside. It's really just wonderful. It makes you so proud and hopeful to recognize that this heritage was given to us, but very sad and discouraged that it was so little understood. So I'm going to quote from the first appendix of Eager to Love, which is called A Dynamic Unity Between Jesus of Nazareth and the Cosmic Christ. Because most of us were not raised with any notion of the cosmic Christ, right? It was all Jesus of Nazareth. You were all told you should fall in love with Jesus without teaching you how to fall in love with Christ. And those are two different levels of love. To love the Christ is to love everything. And that's why we have lovers of Jesus who are racists, right? To be very, very honest. That's why we have lovers of Jesus who are class society people. They haven't undergone the great revolution of consciousness at all. Huh? They tried to love a little private Jesus that looked like from the south of the United States, nothing against the south, but little to do with the great revelation that we were given. So I begin this first appendix with a quote from the book of Revelation, right, the last chapter of the Bible, chapter 21. I am making the whole of creation new. It will come true. It is already done. I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the beginning and the end. Let me just read the first paragraphs. I begin with this scripture passage at the very end of the Bible to ask you a question. Is this Jesus of Nazareth speaking here, or is this someone else? Whoever is talking here is offering an entire and optimistic arc to all of history that the Alpha and the Omega have to match. How it started is how it will end. This is much more than a mere religious message. It is a historical and cosmic message. It declares a definite trajectory where there is a coherence between the beginning and the end. It came from God, and as our Franciscan philosopher, theologian Saint Bonaventure put it, everything that came forth from God will return to God. Now that makes sense. We're going to talk more about the Trinity tonight. But once you see God as much more, and I hope you don't mind me using a geometric image, but the image you and I were raised with was pyramid theology or elevator theology. You know, God is up there, out there, and our job is to get pure and get up there with where God is. That's precisely the movement that Jesus came to undo when he emptied himself and became human and loved and forgave everything human. We reversed the great trajectory of the incarnation. And so the only way we could get back into this flow, well, it wasn't a flow, it was a pyramid again. It was all about climbing theology, at which most of us failed. But if you can switch your image, which is what I'm trying to do in this new book on the Trinity, let go of the pyramid and replace it with what it was meant to be from the very beginning, and what the early fathers of the church called a circle dance. Do you know that is the word from Greek theater that the Cappadocian fathers in the 4th century first used to describe the new nature of God? If what Jesus says is true, that he is unconditionally loved by his Father, and that Father he exemplifies and brings into the world and then passes over to the Spirit, and that that eternal flow never stops. That's a very different notion of God. God is not top down. God is now circular and centrifugal force, pulling you in. So the wonderful thing is this just so fits modern physics and modern cosmology, because that's the pattern from the atom to the galaxies and to every biological creation on this earth. It's all about dynamic flow. So we really, until we can re-understand Jesus in this cosmic sense of a message he brought into the world to transform our consciousness and to bring us back into what the early fathers called the bosom of the Father, I think we'll always get into this win-lose, and in which most people lose, by the way. I mean, and we settle for that, that the vast majority of people, frankly, went to hell. Which, you know, is not in the whole Pentateuch. It's not in any of the letters of our Gospel of John. It's not in Paul's letters. It's mostly based on the metaphors used by Matthew's Gospel. And for some reason, the mind is simply attracted to anything threatening and punitive and damning. I had a student in our Living School class in January who was a neuroscientist. You'll find this interesting, and those of you who teach meditation will find it especially interesting. He said, we now know in neuroscience that when your mind has a negative, oppositional, antagonistic, fearful thought, you attract it like Velcro. You do. You do. That's really bad news. But until you notice that and see that you're doing it every 30 seconds, some of you are probably hating me right now. And you know, and you know, it has nothing to do with me. That's the way you operate. And until you see that I hate almost everybody, or everybody who doesn't say things the way I'm used to hearing them said. But the message gets more compelling. He said, not only is the brain attracted like Velcro to negative and fearful thoughts, but positive, grateful, joyous hallelujahs like we just celebrated, they're like, sorry, Teflon. I just think about it. It's very hard for you to hold on to joy. Very hard. In fact, then he goes further. This is the third piece of this good little teaching on contemplation. We now have evidence, he said, and this was a neuroscientist. I'm not a scientist. I have to learn from them. But he says, the mind has to consciously savor a positive, grateful, joyous thought for a minimum of 15 seconds, minimum, or it will not imprint on the brain. Whereas negative, fearful thoughts you can just grab onto. So when we base the whole gospel on threatening people with hellfire and brimstone, it worked. And you parents probably understand that. I mean, it does work much more effectively when the little brats are running around the house and you want to control them, threaten them. It's far more quickly effective, not long-term effective, but short-term it gives you the peace you want for the next 5 minutes. It doesn't really help them, or in the final instance doesn't help you, because it avoids transformation in preference to transaction. Both, mostly we've been raised in a transactional theology. So anyway, what I try to say, and as I said, this was always the Franciscan school, but we were a minority position inside of the Catholic Church. In the 13th century, the Catholic Church was, frankly, much more broad-minded than it is in later centuries. After the Reformation, we circled the wagon and became very defensive. But in the 13th century at Paris and Bologna and Cologne, we had these great debates. And the debating society was called the Franciscans and the Dominicans, right? And they always won, damn it. They were the smart guys. You know, the smart guys went to the Dominicans, the not so smart guys, we became Franciscans. And the amazing thing is, I'm not bragging, well, I really am, is that 7-8 centuries later, we're winning almost every one of the debates. We are. It's just like we never accepted the substitutionary atonement theory. We said Christmas was already Easter. Do you know that? We're the ones who popularized Christmas. Once God chose to become a human being, then it's good to be a human being. You don't have to wait for a blood sacrifice. The message is already clear in the crib, that if God can become a vulnerable little child, subject to our whims, then God is humble, God is available, God is accessible. It changes everything. You don't have to wait for Easter, right? It's a two-point system. You get it on both ends. But once we made it all into a miracle, as I said in the homily, an anomalous miracle that happened one time in the life of Jesus, and we thought this was the proof that ours was the true religion because Jesus rose from the dead. It's not meant to be a miracle. It's meant to be a revelation of this is the pattern. This is the final chapter of history. This is the way it works in you, too. But we didn't understand transformational religion, huh? That whatever you say about the Christ, you say about the soul. Got it? Whatever you say about the Christ, you say about creation. And what the Christ walks, the course of his journey, is the course of human transformation, ending in resurrection and returning to history as the forgiving victim. There's the basis of radical compassion. But you've got to know, brothers and sisters, once we made redemption itself an act of necessary violence, it legitimated the myth of redemptive violence, as Walter Wink calls it, all the way down. Well, I mean, let's be honest. Christianity has not been known for nonviolence, all right? God was violent. You understand? If God's violent, it's okay for you to be violent. You've got to redeem it at the core. And for me, and that's why I wrote this new book on the Trinity, until we get the foundation relaid on a Trinitarian spirituality, the whole thing can't be rebuilt all from the bottom up. And this is happening. Many theologians are predicting that the next 100 years will be the rediscovery of Trinitarian Christianity. That the nature of God, as Cynthia Bourgeau would say, is the law of three, not the law of two. When you operate inside of the law of two, everything is antagonistic. You always have to choose sides. You always do. Republican, Democrat, Catholic, Protestant, male, female, all of them a waste of time, right? If you're going to choose one side and damn the other, which is what most people do when you're only offered two. And it's the law of three that moves us into a dynamic flow. The law of three, as even Hegel in his own unique way, and Gurdjieff and others, is the only thing that breaks open the flow of antagonistic thinking to the third something. So I love to say that this, strictly speaking, now don't call me a heretic, don't run out of the room, all right? Strictly speaking, theologically speaking, it is not correct to call Jesus God. All right, don't get upset. Because you miss the real transformative message. Jesus is a third something, the human of fully God and fully human. That's different than just blandly saying Jesus is God. That's what happened when we pulled him out of the Trinity. We needed a God figure. We pushed him back up there, you understand? And who lost out was the dynamic flow. Now, I know you healthy feminists are a little upset still. Why am I using that dang word, father? Well, first of all, we've got to redeem it and find that for many people it's going to be necessary to find their own radical compassion, to find that even male love can be unconditional and compassionate and good. But as Cynthia says, and only a woman, she's an Episcopal woman priest who teaches at our school, she says, Don't try to genderize the Trinity. You can call them all feminine if you want, all masculine, all neuter. Because the important thing isn't the name of the persons, it's the relationship between them. Let me repeat that, right? And when you spend too much time arguing about the gender, you forget, and you know, the women still lose. The Father and Son were still masculine, and the Spirit we tried to make feminine, which was good. But go ahead, make all of them beautiful feminine names. The only thing is, what is going to open your heart space? That's the only thing that matters. It's all about transformation. What's going to pull you into the flow? For many people, only a feminine image will be able to do that. If your solid or first experience of love was from a woman. For many who are still longing for a male love that they can trust or rest in, it's gonna need to be a male image. They're both needed at different times in the human journey. So let's not waste any time saying this is the only name. Read the entire Bible. There are a good 150 metaphorical names for God in the Bible, right? And once you forget that they're all metaphors, did you hear that? That's what fundamentalism didn't understand. They really think the story of the ugly duckling is about ducks. I mean, it's like, this is literature 101. But for some reason, we want absolutes when we get into the world of religion. So we take marvelous spiritual texts, like I tried to unfold for you at the homily this morning, and we minimize them, you understand? Where they didn't have cosmic, archetypal, universal truth, huh? But just we had to prove that Jesus really walked through doors. Got it? All right? I have no trouble believing that, but that isn't the point, do you understand? But that's where our religion is trapped, at that lower level of thinking the ugly duckling is about ducks. Right? It's always pointing to something bigger than that, truer than that. We basically have to learn how to read spiritual texts. And once you do that, it isn't really, children do it easier than adults. Do you know that? Children already are not fundamentalists by now. Oh, they hear it in a simplistic way, but they're not tied to it the way adults are. They can move around inside of it. They don't have to prove this is the one and only interpretation of the text. And, you know, again, to bring it home, I think what is happening now in American politics is revealing once and for all, well, it probably won't work, but it's trying, the bankruptcy, forgive me, of American Christianity. It is. That so many people who fervently call themselves Christian cannot see through what is happening. There's no discernment of spirits. There's no deep third eye seeing of what's happening and what's really happening. Now, when we haven't trained people in what's really happening to perceive that power and money and war are controlling everything, I'm sounding like I'm a Bernie Sanders fan now, but that's not my point. But if we can't see that, hiding behind religious vocabulary, as it always loves to do, I don't think Christianity has achieved its purposes of raising up enlightened people. So light is not something you see. Light is that by which you see. And when we speak of enlightening people, we're giving them the epistemology, the new eyes, how to know spiritual things in a spiritual way. So let me stop at that. That gives us 15 minutes to let you ask some questions.
Let me start by asking you, you recently were interviewed and said some powerful things about white privilege.
They can't hear you.
You recently said some powerful things in an interview about white privilege, and that's a problem also, and if you could weave that into what you've just been saying and help us see some light there.
I've found that it's almost the only way that we educated, sophisticated white folks can recognize how we're structurally trapped even though we might be personally enlightened, huh? Like, I'm sure any of you who'd come to this church or listen to me, you would certainly consider yourself not a racist, huh? No, we're beyond that, you know? And remember, the ego is always trying to make itself superior to what it really is. So who wants to think of themselves as a low-level racist? But the fact that we have all, and me too, even though I was from a German farm family in Kansas, you know, which isn't known for progressive thinking, I might add. I didn't recognize really till the late 60s, I don't think, how much the whole system was just a paved pathway for me to succeed. You know? I never had to prove myself. I felt I belonged everywhere. I could walk in any institution and be trusted. I had this nice white skin and could talk sophisticated enough to look educated. So that's what we mean by white privilege. It's a structural thing that those of us who were born white and born middle class and born heterosexual, we all like to think of ourselves as normal. Isn't that nice? And do you hear the self-referential nature of that? It's normally called narcissism, right? We're structurally narcissistic, huh? And we never realized that. And if I hadn't worked in the jail for 14 years, if I hadn't traveled to so many poorer countries, where I had to see, you know, I'm not the norm anymore. I'm not the center of reference. It's not all about me, suddenly. Huh? You've got to plant yourself somewhere in your life outside of the world where you are the dominant consciousness, where you set the rules, where you define what's health, what's success, what's true, what's... I think, as I said this in my meditations last week, I think this isn't... Jesus didn't tell us to go to the poor to help them, although it has that side effect. But Jesus told us to go to the poor to save ourselves. You've got to meet some people who are not playing your success game by your rules and your morality and your middle-class American white worldview and recognize, my gosh, she's happier than I am, or he's freer than I am. That's got to happen to you once, or there's something essential you don't know. Huh? Something very essential, central and foundational that you don't know. So any of you who are privileged to be in any kind of minority position, right? A sexual minority, a racial minority, a class minority, a skin color minority, the gospel would say you're in the privileged position. You've got a head start. Because you know from your earliest years, ask any gay person, they know from their earliest years, you know, the world isn't like everybody thinks it is. And they have to keep that big secret all their life. Thank God now they don't have to. Can you imagine what it's like? I know it isn't like everybody thinks, that it's either male or female. They know that in their body. Huh? That's what I mean by they have a head start. So I don't want to tie it too much to white skin. Because the real thing is power privilege, you know. Power is the issue that Jesus undercuts. And that's why he always identifies with the powerless. He's always healing and transforming the powerless. Why? Because they're more accessible, available, ready, and yearning for transformation. Whereas those of us who are comfortable and smug, let's be honest, we don't need the gospel. We don't. It's just a little way to feel superior. That's all. So, no.
Questions? Raise your hand. We'll get the mics to you. We need mics, please. So, right there. Okay. Go ahead, Nancy.
You mentioned metaphor a few minutes ago.
We'll come back to you. Hi, Joe. Go ahead. Yes.
Hi. You mentioned metaphor a few minutes ago. Would you mind expanding on that?
I'd love to talk for an hour. Yeah.
But specifically, the role of metaphor in discovering truth?
Discovering truth?
Yes.
Yeah. God, I have so many quotes from other people. There's one in my Trinity book on it, too. The Greek word, I had 6 years of Greek forced on me. I was never good at it, but I had to learn some of it. Metaphor means to carry across. So you carry across a meaning by, you see, when you state truth too directly, it sets in the oppositional mind. I'm going to disprove you. I'm going to show that you're wrong by that declarative sentence of what is the nature of truth. Wasn't it Emily Dickinson who said, tell the truth, but tell it slant, S-L-A-N-T, you know? So many writers, novelists, dramatists know that, huh? That the only way the ego does not resist great truth is it has to be put in the form of beauty. That was very much at the heart of Franciscan spirituality. If it isn't beautiful, the soul will push against it, do you understand? We call it soft prophecy instead of angry prophecy. That it was a different approach to telling the truth. And that will most often successfully take the form of poetry, art, music, or preaching that seduces the soul instead of shames the soul. And we've been so raised on shaming that I think some of us almost don't know how to respond to metaphor, which is, I mean, read the poetry of Mary Oliver, huh? She seduces you in every single poem, you know, into the natural world, into the God relationship. And in many ways, she might be a better preacher than a lot of us preachers, because Mary Oliver, along with many other great poets, knows how to use metaphor well. And she carries you across without you recognizing you're being carried across, and therefore your resistance can't check in. Got it? That's what I mean by being seduced. Oh, God, that's beautiful. Ooh, God, I'm stirring in here, you know? This is touching my heart. And until you open up the heart space, normally the mind space will not change. It will not. The Dalai Lama has been saying that for years. Okay, Joe, you had one. Yeah, I haven't seen you for years. Good to see you.
In your meditation that came out this morning called The Larger Knowing, it really dovetails with a lot of what you're saying. And there's one particular part of it that I was intrigued by. It is the part you said to be contemplative, to kind of let God in. We've got to surrender some of the boundaries of our ego and our identities. And it was that word some that was intriguing me. How do we distinguish between what the kind of boundaries we really do need to let go of, but what do we need
and
to
what
hang
are the
on
necessary
to?
Well, that's why I wrote the Falling Upward book, to say there are some needed containers. Any good therapist will tell you that. You've got to have ego boundaries and ego identity to enough space of identity to find, to bring freedom into it, to put it that way. By the way, I already wrote the staff back in Albuquerque. The second sentence in today's meditation has a major typo in it. It's supposed to be, we have to know from the inside out, and some editor between me and the press got it outside in. So if that bothered you in today's meditation, I was so upset. That's my one on the Enneagram. Why did they do that, you know? Because it misses the point. But back to your point. You need enough boundaries to hold together your true self. Now, that's another hour talk, all right? You need enough boundaries to hold together what's good about being you. Let's just put it that way. And when you have that container, here's the paradox. To know your soul, your identity in God, we would say theologically or spiritually, your true self. The paradox of that is when you have a big dose of goodness, it's strong enough to absorb badness. There's the paradox. That you don't have to spend the rest of your life denying your shadow. Are projecting your shadow onto other races or other religions or other people. True goodness, true perfection, is precisely the ability to absorb imperfection. I have a chapter in this book on that, which I call the Franciscan genius, that Francis didn't waste any time avoiding the negative. He embraced it, you know? He didn't run from it, he revealed it and said, I wear patches on the outside of my habit so everybody know I'm patched up inside too, you know? And you think what a different kind of Christianity that is, where most of us had to dress up to go to church, to present our positive exterior. So the good boundaries are the boundaries that were given you by early mirroring for the most part, where someone usually starts with the mother's delightful gaze in her little baby's eyes, and we now know it releases oxytocin in both the baby and the mother. And I'm sure the same when the father makes eye contact. That's what we call mirroring. And that's your first sense of I am a me that is beloved. At that moment, when your mommy or your dad gazed at you with sheer delight, your mommy was God for you. Your daddy was God for you. And that begins the formation of a positive sense of identity. So much so, let me repeat it, that you don't need to protect it or defend it the rest of your life. You've got it. I don't need to prove that Catholics are the only people going to heaven. I know better. I don't need to prove that Americans are the country that God has shed his grace on and he barely tolerates the other countries of the world. I can let go of all these illusions. The ego has to pretend that stuff when it didn't get the primal mirroring. Now, let me end that by saying, that for me, and I talk about this in the new Trinity book, is the real meaning of prayer. Allowing yourself to be gazed on unconditionally by God. The Indians call that darshan, where you go into the temple not to see God, but to let God see you. And you stay in the temple as long as it takes for you to get naked before God and to let God see you exactly as you are. So here, to have good boundaries, another paradox, mysterious things are always paradoxical, it seems. That's non-dual thinking that can allow that, is that this real strong sense of container, our identity, has what the biologists call a semi-permeable membrane. It, just like the Trinity, it gets out and it gets in. It moves in both directions, receiving and giving, giving and receiving, giving and receiving. So a firm boundary is ironically a not so overprotected boundary. I don't need to keep advertising. I'm happy to wear my brown Franciscan robe. I didn't need to wear it today to prove to you I'm a Franciscan. Do you understand? I don't need to wear my Catholic badge. I don't need to wear my American badge because I've internalized what's good about all those things. But I don't need to overstate them. And what we're having in the culture wars in America, because we have so, in my opinion, because we have so much immature religion, is people with very poor sense of boundaries are grabbing at republicanism or conservativism or democratism, anything. This is my identity. You will wrap your ego around some external ideology when you don't know who you are, to use Paul's marvelous phrase, hidden with Christ in God. Who you are from all eternity and always will be. You can't get it, you can't lose it, because you already have it. You understand? That's the good news. That's the message that changes people and rebuilds the psyche from the bottom up. You see, from the bottom up. Thank you.
So wait a minute, we're going to do that.
So we're going to thank Richard, but I just wanted to transact some business. So Richard preaches at the 11:15 liturgy in the church. There's room for everybody. We're so sorry that we couldn't accommodate everyone in here today. And his presentation tonight at 7 will be in the church, so there will be room for absolutely everyone. And the books you buy today, he will be available at 8:30 around our quitting time for people to sign, for him to sign books then. He can't sign now, he got to go to the liturgy. Now, let us express our gratitude to Richard Rohr.